Welcome back to the Chevy MLB pregame show on Fox. Chevy, baseball's number one fan in American Revolution.
The Mets head into Yankee Stadium with the National League's best record, but do they also have the best left side of the infield? Well, it's safe to say the Mets have the best bargain. Reyes, right, make just slightly more money than what the Yankees are paying Robinson Cano and Bubba Crosby this season. Jeter Rodriguez are paid more than the total of payrolls for three teams. But which combo is more money with the leather and lumber?
Because they're exciting to watch. They're fun to watch.
Watch this kid go. He can fly.
You're talking about a guy with numerous World Series rings.
A three-run home run for the captain.
Another guy that, you know, is an MVP candidate year in, year out.
An A-bomb from A-Rod.
I love him. I'm having a great time watching him.
A monstrous homer off the bat of David Wright.
I think they carry themselves the right way. They play the game the right way. They both seem to be having fun, and I enjoy watching them play.
Their abilities are great, but they're very humble. They're very great young ambassadors of our game. And they're just doing a wonderful job, playing good baseball.
When you play the same positions in the same city where the battle for the back page is a daily ritual, the comparisons are inevitable. But Wright and his partner in Flushing know they have a long way to go to match the achievements of their counterparts in the Bronx.
They're playing in the same town, playing the same positions. It's a fun comparison, but, we're a ways to go before we're at that level.
Both the youngsters have played at an all-star level this season, but they understand they have a lot to learn and they're still a work in progress. Reyes, for one, has worked on being more patient at the plate, and it's paying off.
This year, I get in base a lot, and every time I get in base, something is going to happen for the New York Mets.
Through the middle, base hit, and Reyes has hit for the cycle.
Reyes is coming off consecutive weeks as the NL Player of the Week, the first of which he shared with his teammate, Wright. Reyes' speed is lethal, while Wright's power is clutch. The combination may land the duo at the All-Star game.
You look at the All-Star ballot and you see your name up there with the Scott Rolands, the Chipper Joneses. It's pretty humbling, but it would be exciting. The fans, from day one have come out in full force and supported both myself and Jose, and now for them to come out in full force and hopefully vote us into this All-Star game, it'd be pretty fun.
Swung on, there it goes to deep left. It is high, it is far, it is gone.
There's one guy that you're going to try to mold your game after, a guy like Derek Jeter's a guy.
So the way he played the game, because he played the game hard, and I enjoy watching him play.
It wasn't too long ago that I was a kid and I was watching guys on TV, and now you have guys coming into the league saying they enjoyed watching me play. So it's kind of funny, but it makes you feel good.
Atrás, la pelota se va, y despídala con un beso. Cuadrangular de José Reyes.
We have a thing at Shea Stadium, learning Spanish with Profesor Reyes, that they do in between innings, so I'm picking up a little bit from him.
He's doing okay, not too good, but he got there a little bit.
This offseason, I'm going to, come back speaking Spanish and not tell anybody so that I can pick up on the little things.
I think he just did tell a few people.
Yes, he did. First time all four All-Star starters at the left side of the infield will come from the same city, starting with Derek Jeter and, of course, Jose Reyes. And Derek Jeter, it's hard to believe, he's in his 12th season in the big leagues already. Alex Rodriguez, David Wright, comparing those numbers, you can see Alex Rodriguez, of course, it's hard to believe for him, too. In his 13th season, I remember, Gene, back
in the day.
Everyone
else is getting older but us. Now, the other thing they have in common. You can't see the ladies gathering around there because the security is keeping them at bay. We're just passing along both heartthrobs. Jeter with some advice for Reyes when they met at Shea last time on being a young shortstop in New York.
Well, he's excited.
Keep smiling, keep your head up, no matter what happens.
Reyes is excited, yeah. One of the most in the game.
Good things, of course, come in pairs. Bad news tends to come in threes, and that is fair to say when you talk about the White Sox, Jim Thome, Jermaine Dye, and Paul Konerko. This trio makes things happen. Their collective resume includes the most homers among any three teammates in the major leagues. And you thought Michael Barrett packed a punch.
That ball is crushed down the right field line. It's a 1-0 game. A four-bagger for Jim Thome.
That ball hit deep. Way back. Taguchi looks up. You can put it on the board. Yes.
That ball high. Way back.
Home run for Jermaine Dye.
I think being in a lineup with these guys in it, I think it helps. It pushes you individually. To know that, hey, we have a good enough team where we all can have success.
It's just great to be in a lineup where you don't have to put all the pressure on yourself. You got other guys that could
handle some of the pressure and know that they can do a job for us.
There's different nights where different one of us shows up or even other guys on the team. I mean, it's not always Jim has to do it or I have to do it. I mean, if I have a bad night, Jermaine usually has a good night. It just kind of goes like that.
It's great to be in the lineup with these two guys. When you take a walk, you know, you got these guys behind you, and they can drive you in really easy.
Sometimes I can actually see the pitcher has been physically worn down by facing him.
I get to watch how the pitcher's pitching these guys. So in my case, I have a game plan going up there and hopefully drive them in.
When you play us, you can't give the same answer every week. When you play the Red Sox, you know which two guys you can't have beat you.
They're very good hitters, and I think they should get the notoriety. And I think what's been great is we're kind of the quiet ones there. So it's, in that sense, it's been really good.
I think we stress a lot just trying to win series and not trying to go out and win every game. I think if we do that, we'll be fine.
I think the main thing also is our top of the lineup's been good, and the guys hitting at 6, 7, 8. Yeah, we've had a lot of damage being done by those guys. And when that happens, there's only so many places you can run. You have to pitch to somebody after a while. It's all one unit and it works together.
Ozzie Guillen likes offense as far as with the running game, but boy, he's got power in the middle, Genie. Jim Thome, Paul Konerko, Jermaine Dye, they compare favorably with the three guys back in the days with the Indians. So Jim Thome was in the middle of that, and it's also with 25 home runs for Jim Thome, it's the third time before the All-Star break that he's had that many with three different teams, including, of course, the Philadelphia Phillies.
All right, hey, before we get you out to the ballgame, thoughts and prayers going out to Hall of Famer Peter Gammons, broadcaster, longtime sports writer who is recovering from brain surgery. Get well, Peter. Our schedule jam-packed. At Yankee Stadium, Mystique and Awe can take the day off. According to the New York Mets, these kids from the other side of the track expect W. And with the White Sox back in friendly confines, this time they hope to land the knockout punch on what's left of the season for Greg Maddux and the Cubs. Talk about your Texas two-step with the Astros and Rangers headed in the wrong direction. They're both looking for a boot on Fox Saturday Baseball. It is your game of the week.
Welcome to the Bronx as these fans file in for another version of the Subway Series. It's Interleague Baseball. It continues today. The Fox Saturday Baseball Game of the Week. New York, New York. The Mets and the Yankees from the Bronx. And now welcome to our broadcast booth, everybody. I'm Joe Buck. Tim McCarver is coming up in just a second. The Mets come in having lost four in a row, three of them at the beginning of that stretch to the Boston Red Sox. Does it bother the Mets? Probably not. They still have a 10.5 game lead over Florida in the NL East. But you can guarantee that the Yankees took notice. They, along with the rest of baseball, know how good the Boston Red Sox are. First, we'll talk about the Mets. If you look at it from their perspective, they have a lot to be very happy about, and they, I think, are clearly the best team in the National League.
Yeah, if you're a Mets fan, you've seen this club play for 3 months. 3 months of superb baseball, four losses. They're too deep, they're too balanced, and they've got too big a lead to worry right now.
On the other side, though, the Yankees now, because of what's going on in the AL Central, you've got two hot teams with the White Sox and the Tigers. You may now have to win your division in the AL East to get to the playoffs. If that's the case, they've got their hands full with the Boston Red Sox.
On the other hand, it's a game of rationalizing, and if you're a team that's had as much go wrong as the Yankees have this year, you're very happy to be only three games behind one of the hottest teams in baseball.
And they have Randy Johnson pitching today. A week from Tuesday, the All-Star game in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. A lot of those stars will be on display here today from the Mets and Thank you, Bono. It is a beautiful day. 84 degrees. Humidity is down. A little breeze through the park. Just listen to Bono. Randy Johnson takes his long, slow walk out to the mound to take on the New York Mets, and we take a look at the lineup he will have to deal with. It's sponsored by Taco Bell. It'll be Reyes leading it off. What a month he is coming off of. Paul LoDuca is the DH. Carlos Beltran is in center. David Wright, what a month he had in the month of June. Julio Franco is the first baseman. Xavier Nady in right. And it's Woodward getting the start at second base. Castro the catcher, and Eli Marrero a rare start. Out in left field because of the presence of the big left-hander. All 6'10", 231 pounds of him. coming off three very good starts, Tim, Randy Johnson.
Well, his season, he had three good starts, 11 bad starts, poor starts, and his last three have been superb, his most recent last Monday against the Atlanta Braves. If he's on top of the ball, he's on top of the game, and he's pretty easy to see that from the first base dugout, the Yankee dugout, and Joe Torre and Ron Guidry will keep an eye on that. If he delivers the ball with the flat hand, he's pushing it, the ball flattens out. If he's on top of it, it goes down, and that's a good thing for the Yankees.
You are witnessing our pitcher profile for Randy Johnson. It's brought to you by Axon and Mobile Retailers. And with Randy in the middle of this diamond, who's around him? The defense for the Yankees brought to you by Gillette Fusion in the outfield, Melky, Johnny, and Bubba. With Rodriguez, Jeter, Cairo, and Phillips around the infield, Jorge Posada is catching Randy Johnson. Well, what do you think they need? What do you think they need, Tim? He just turned 32 this past week. He can't believe it. He says once you hit 30, you go backward. He's really only 28. Derek Jeter, who was a rookie of the year and a World Series champion back in 96. I think the Yankees need a starter. Do they need an outfielder? Or do they need bullpen help as they try to assess the trade market?
I think they need more than just one player. When you look at the New York Mets, I think the Mets are going to try to bolster their ball club with one pitcher. I don't think one pitcher is going to be enough to put the Yankees over the hill. That's a wrong term to use.
Over the top.
Over the top when you're facing a tough ball club like the Boston Red Sox, who's playing about as well as you can play.
Why do you want to back off from saying over the hill, Tim?
I have an aversion to that term.
On the hill is Randy Johnson taking his own sweet time. Jose Reyes is getting set to go. And Randy has got his internal clock that says right now at 127 on the scoreboard, it's time for my first pitch. And I'm going to throw a strike. Reyes, LoDuca, and Beltran against Joe Torre's big left-hander here in the first inning. And Reyes sticks the bat out and pops it into right, leadoff base hit. Rear end was going one way, and the bat and the baseball was going the other.
It's almost as though Rick Down, the batting instructor of the Mets, would rather see an off-balance swing by Reyes than a good swing. And he gets a good swing, he hits a lot of fly balls the other way and to center field, but that rear end out hit it off the end of the bat, and Reyes is on, and there is no more catalytic converter in the game than Jose Reyes.
He's the best, 34 stolen bases, number one in the major leagues. LoDuca's in that key number two spot as the Mets are trying to snap a four-game losing streak. Reyes not only leads the Mets, but the Mets lead the major leagues in the stolen base department. So Willie Randolph has used what he was given with regard to speed in this Mets roster, and he has let him go. Randy Johnson is a guy that once you read his move, is easy to run against.
Right. Even though he's a left-hander, and most left-handers should have better moves, but you think of the speed on this Mets ball club. Beltran can run. David Wright can run. Indy Chavez can run, and the best is on base now.
Oh, look at that. That slide step. You think that Reyes doesn't bother a pitcher? Randy Johnson barely lifted his right foot off the ground.
Good thing Randy's not pitching over a curb. Hit a tripped.
I don't think I've ever seen him pitch out of the stretch like that.
Yeah, and I don't think you can do that either. You got to forget the speed on base and pitch your game and get the guy with the stick in his hand.
There's a more conventional leg kick, and it's an extra base hit down the left field line. Reyes will go to third. Cabrera digs it out. It's a double for LoDuca, and the Mets are in business in the first. Two batters today after picking up one hit all of last night. They have two already against Randy Johnson.
You can see on top of the ball, but he's behind in the count. LoDuca looking for the fastball. He got it. But again, speed affects pitchers in so many different ways. At first pitch, he fell behind LoDuca. It called for a more controlled pitch. LoDuca got it and doubled.
So a single, a double. Beltran hits it in the air down the left field line, foul and out of play. Carlos much better this year in year two for the Mets than he was in year one. For the most part, he's been healthy. And in his career, he's a 429 hitter against Randy Johnson. That's the third best average among active players against this 6'10 left-hander. 0-2. Nobody wears his emotions and his mood on his sleeve, so to speak, more in baseball than Randy Johnson. His body language is a window to his soul. And more times than not, especially this year, he has had that look with the shoulders slumping, frustration, glaring in at the home plate umpire, bothered by everything that's going on around him. And let's see how he deals with second and third, nobody out against the Mets. Beltran, a good job to spoil that pitch.
Yeah, normally you've heard that expression, the eyes are the windows of the soul, but with Randy Johnson, it's his 6'10 frame. That's the window to the soul.
18 first inning runs and his 17 starts. In trouble here in the first. Ball one.
That was a good pitch right there. Not every pitch is designed to get a hitter out. Sometimes that fastball, you can see Posada up in the strike zone. Johnson wanted to go in, and it was a ball. But right now, Randy Johnson's releasing the ball from where Ron Guidry preaches to release the ball, on top of it.
Beltran pops it up. That's a big out for the Yankees as Cairo settles under it. One down. So Beltran is erased, and David Wright, one of the most exciting young players in baseball, will dig in coming off a phenomenal June. Hit 327. Number two in baseball in home runs with 10 during June. And his RBI total, one of the best single months of any Met hitter ever. 29 RBIs, and he has second and third, one out. Strike one. Wright is number five in the league with his 64 RBIs and the seventh best average at 324. Reyes at third. LoDuca at second, one down. In the air to left. Cabrera going to get it. Can't. And two runs will score. David Wright delivers for the Mets, 2-0.
Here at Yankee Stadium, it's the most spacious left field in the game. Seems like a ball with this much hang time has got to be caught from an outfielder with good speed. Melky Cabrera running and running and running and just couldn't catch up to this ball. One of the reasons is that left center field, Joe Torre once said that here at Yankee Stadium, you need a center fielder playing left and a center fielder playing center. Well, they don't have a center fielder playing left.
Franco is upset with strike one called by Jerry Davis, longtime Major League umpire. He thought it was high, and they have a conversation. They're about the same age, Franco and Jerry Davis. Runner at second, one out. 2-0 Mets here in the first inning. And Julio did not go. One ball, one strike.
I think the Mets got a break there. Looked to me like Franco went too far.
I would agree. Tim McClellan, with respect for his elders, did not ring up Julio Franco. One ball, one strike for a guy who broke into the big leagues in 1982. Now in the hole, 1-2. And he is remarkable. Not just that he's still playing and contributing, he is much more than just a spare part. He is a part-time starter, important in these games against American League teams. Ricky Henderson seated next to Omar Minaya, the general manager for the Mets, and Ricky has been brought in to instruct during the week with all this speed that the Mets have. But Franco is a guy that, with his body and the shape that he's in, thinks he can play another couple of years, and why not? 2-2.
That's where you want to stay on him also. You can tie him up upstairs. The only ball he's going to pull is a ball down in the strike zone. Instead of worrying about away and inside to Franco, you try to keep the ball up.
Julio will turn 48 August 23rd. The 2-2 pitch. Johnson made a good pitch. A-Rod makes the throw. High but out. Two down. Wright still at second, and the inning will continue for Xavier Nady.
Xavier Nady, number 22.
If you hear the voice in the background, that is not the familiar voice of Bob Shepard here at Yankee Stadium. Instead, that's their PR director, Rick Cerrone. Not the former catcher, but the longtime PR director here and in Pittsburgh for a while before that. He's filling in for Bob Shepard, who has laryngitis. Left after one inning last night, and so Rick Cerrone took over last night, and he's got the duties again today. He is back there in the depths of the press box doing his thing. One ball, no strikes on Xavier Nady. That's just inside. Johnson wanted the call, didn't get it. 2-0.
Bob Shepard, one of the real gentlemen of the game, over 90 years old and known here at Yankee Stadium as the voice of God.
Part of the experience of watching baseball here at Yankee Stadium. It's not the same without him. No disrespect to Rick Cerrone, who's doing his best and doing a fine job, but there's only one Bob Shepard. Two balls and a strike on Nady. He was hit during the week in a series in Boston by Julian Tavares in the wrist. There's actually a broken bone in there, but after taking a couple of days off, not even hitting at all last night, he's in the lineup today. Also coming off an appendectomy. 2-1 pitch. Inside, and Johnson now is really ticked off. 3-1.
Some of those emotions you were talking about, Joe. And that fastball did miss inside. But as far as a release point, you hear that so often in baseball, but his release point is good in the, here in the first inning.
So if you're Guidry, two runs or not, you're pleased with the way he's throwing.
You're happy, absolutely.
Nady pops it up to the right side. Should be playable for Cairo. Some of the kids doing their thing for the first place Mets, a 10.5 game lead in the NL East. And those kids combined for two runs in the first. Driven in by David Wright. 2-0 Mets with the Yankees coming up. Fox Saturday Baseball sponsored by your Exxon and Mobil retailers. We're drivers too. By the new Spicy Chicken Crunchwrap Supreme at Taco Bell. It's good to go. By the Power Stripe from Right Guard. Right Guard right to the end of the day. And by Chevy, baseball's number one fan. Chevy, an American revolution. What a great day to be out on the water. Happy 4th of July weekend.
Beautiful.
To everybody watching today, and the Taco Bell starting lineup for the Yankees. Johnny Damon leads it off. Then it's Jeter, Giambi. A-Rod is cleaning up. Jorge Posada, Andy Phillips, Melky Cabrera, Bubba Crosby, and Miguel Cairo is at second base, taking over for the injured Robinson Cano, who the Yankees will miss over the next couple of weeks. Damon hitting 292 takes a strike against Steve Trachsel, a six-game winner, 4-0 his last five starts, but he has been giving up a lot of runs along the way. ERA up near 5, and Damon starts the day with a hit. Our Our pitcher profile for Trachsel is brought to you by our Exxon and Mobil retailers.
Sometimes you can't get the glove down quickly enough. That ball hit right through the wickets, and one of the keys to Steve Traxel's success is to get ahead with strikes and get hitters out with balls out of the strike zone. That pitch a curveball, and watch how late the glove is in coming down. Too late.
So Damon is on, and Derek Jeter will step to the plate. And Randy Johnson will go try and cool off. A check on Damon, who has stolen 16. He's been playing with a broken bone in his foot, but he has been tough enough to gut it out and continue playing, and he has had a very good first year in a Yankee uniform. Jeter with a late swing and a foul off to the right. 144 consecutive at-bats without a home run. His last home run, May 16th. But if there's one team he likes seeing, it's the Mets. Jeter has his highest career average, 368 against the Mets, higher than any other team he faces during the year. Damon goes, and Jeter fouls it.
The difference in the two half innings we saw with Jose Reyes on first, Randy Johnson fall behind to LoDuca. Trachsel ahead of Jeter. It's a lot easier pitching when you're ahead. It's also easier to control the running game when you're ahead.
On that last pitch, and when Damon was going, Tim, the second baseman Woodward was covering, and the entire right side of the infield was wide open, and that's where Jeter likes to go.
Can't cover with the second baseman against Jeter.
Tough play for Trachsel. Safe. McClellan delayed. And Jeter beat the throw evidently, although I'm interested to look at the replay. Traxel's looking into the dugout at Willie Randolph, waiting for Randolph to run out there and argue, but safe is the call.
Looked like he had him. It looked like he delayed to see whether Franco's foot was on the bag, and it appeared it was, but it wasn't necessarily the out of the safe call. It was how he delivered it. He looked out to me.
I'm with you. And then with McClellan's body language after it,
He's out.
McClellan was looking in around the body of Franco to see if his foot was still on the bag, and it was on the bag the entire time.
Yep.
So the Yankees catch a break, and one of their hottest hitters and biggest producers, Jason Giambi, steps in. It's ruled a hit for Jeter. And instead of Damon at second, one out, it's two on with nobody out. And Giambi, who has hit 24 home runs, went deep last night, waits for a 1-0 pitch. 2-0. Good speed on for the Yankees with Damon at second and Jeter at first. That's low, 3-0. And Giambi, who's number three in the AL in walks, is on his way to another.
See if Joe Torre turns him loose here. A guy as hot as Giambi, you want him swinging 3-0. A guy who last year on this date had five home runs, five for the 2005 season, and he has 24 this year.
Tanking on 3-0. At least, at the very least, he didn't like the pitch, and it's 3-1.
Yeah, manager will give a hitter the take sign, but if it's up in the zone, Giambi likes the ball down. He'll wait for a better one.
A patient slugger. Gets out in front of it and pops it up. Castro couldn't get back initially to make the play. And the Mets aren't going to like that. He had to fight his way through the home plate umpire, Jerry Davis. And by the time he finally got back to the screen, he couldn't adjust to where the baseball was coming down.
Well, he didn't get out of the box cleanly. And had he done so, then he makes the play.
So Giambi gets a second life.
So you have Jeter, who was out at first, call safe, and now this play by Castro. Two big breaks for the Yankees in this inning.
And if the Knicks are looking for a low post guy, Jerry Davis might be somebody they want to call.
Too short.
Here's a 3-2. Runners go. Strike three. Throw to third. Double play. Joe Torre starts the runners, and a 3-2 pitch is taken for strike three, and it's a runner at second, two out.
It's shocking that Giambi takes this pitch because he can see the runners running. Or sometimes you've got to protect the runner, and Giambi frozen. And Johnny Damon out by about 6 feet at third base.
An easy catch and throw for Ramon Castro.
Boy, does that nullify the two breaks the Yankees got prior to that.
So now it's a runner at second, two out. And the reigning AL MVP, who's been hearing it from Yankee Stadium crowds over the past couple of weeks, steps in. Alex Rodriguez with his 55 RBIs. Takes a strike. Rodriguez hit a game-winning home run in the 12th inning against the Atlanta Braves. The final game of that series on Wednesday. He was booed on his way into the batter's box and cheered on his way around the bases. One ball, one strike. The defense for the Mets is brought to you by Gillette Fusion. In the outfield, it's Eli Marrero, Beltran in center, and Xavier Nady in right, with Wright, Reyes, Woodward, and Franco on the infield. And Ramon Castro does the catching for Trachsel. One ball, one strike on Rodriguez. Not close, 2-1. Steve Trachsel last year had to battle his way through a herniated disc in his back. He had surgery last March, made only 6 starts. So far this season, 6-4 with an ERA of 4.82. It's a tough injury from which to bounce back. 2-1, 3-1 on deck is Posada.
What we were talking about in the scouting report, a deep count to Giambi, ran the count to 3-0, and now it's 3-1 to Rodriguez. A lot of deep counts during a game from Steve Trachsel.
Trachsel, who is notorious for being a slow worker, to go along with the deep counts. Takes a long time to get the ball to the plate. With regard to his pace on the mound, is ready for a 3-1. In at the knees, inside corner, full count.
Good splitter right here. We looked at the release of Randy Johnson. All pitching coaches advocate that, staying on top of the ball. When that hand drops down, the ball flattens out, and that's not good.
Three, two count on Rodriguez, ball four, two on, two out. So the Yankees have had two hits, a walk, but a strike them out, throw them out, double play mixed in there, and here is Posada.
Jorge Posada having a marvelous year. And think about this, the leading hitter in the American League is 103 points
higher than Jorge Posada.
And they play the same position.
Yeah, same position. Two catchers. Posada having a marvelous year, and Joe Mauer of the Minnesota Twins leads baseball with a 392 average.
In for a strike from Trachsel, and Posada didn't like the call. Joe Mauer hitting 392. And an old name, an old face, Nomar Garciaparra leading the National League, playing first base for the Dodgers, hitting 365. Two guys we will see a week from Tuesday in Pittsburgh at the All-Star Game. Traxel's 0-1. It's like watching Jim Furyk get ready to putt, watching Traxel pitch. Looks at it, lines it up, steps off, gets behind it, looks at it again, adjusts his pants, gets back on top.
Sometimes he has to putt sliders, screwballs.
Posada hits it in the air to right and into the glove of Xavier Nady. Hardest hit ball of the inning ends the first. Two hits, two left. 2-0 Mets after one. Long-time New York Met and a part of their success in the 80s, Ron Darling in the audience today, and Randy Johnson in self-defense makes the catch of the line drive off the bat of Woodward. One pitch, one out.
Sometimes pitchers are so stunned, the ball is hit so quickly you don't know what to do with it. You can imagine a guy like Randy Johnson, 6'10", the pitching rubber is 60 feet 0.6 inches away from home plate, and when Randy releases it, he's about 52 feet. Look how quickly this ball got back to him. Almost kind of flinch whippy.
Castro hits another one at him.
What's going on? Is this a replay? Instant replay. Oh! All right, guys, somebody's got to go down. That's what Randy. Keep hitting him back here through the middle. What's going on?
He almost smiled.
Yeah, he did. He did. That would be something to get a smile out of Randy Johnson on the day he pitches.
Yeah, while he's pitching. Eli Marrero now. It can't happen three times in a row, can it? Marrero was willing to go with a three-pitch inning there.
Yeah, Randy making sure it didn't happen, going inside. The best way to keep that from happening, all balls hit back through the middle for the most part on pitches away. So Randy says, that's not happening again. I'm throwing you a slider out of the strike zone inside.
0-2. Velocity so far on the fastball has been around 90, 91. Number 9 hitter Eli Marrero is gone on the slider down and in. Caught both of them about chest high. Boy, George, good Lord, 2-0 Mets. Fox Saturday Baseball is sponsored by Budweiser Select. Brewed longer for a bold taste that finishes clean. Expect everything. Bottom of the second inning, Andy Phillips, Melky Cabrera, Bubba Crosby will be the hitters. And here is the area in this lineup, which at the beginning of the season, when everybody was healthy, it looked like they will score 10 runs a game. Who's going to be able to pitch through that lineup when you had Sheffield and Matsui joining Jeter and Damon and Giambi and Rodriguez and Posada? But now 6 through 9, you have Andy Phillips, Melky Cabrera, Bubba Crosby, and Miguel Cairo because of injury. That's outside. It's 3-0 on Phillips, who's hitting 290. He's done well, but at the beginning of the year certainly was not going to get this much playing time. That's outside, a four-pitch walk, and the last two didn't miss by much.
again, that Rick Peterson jotting that down, certainly making a mental note. And there's nothing you can talk to a pitcher about during the game, but 2-3 ball counts, one to Giambi, one to Posada, and now four straight balls to Andy Phillips.
So now Trachsel, with the leadoff man on, will pitch to Melky Cabrera, who hit over 300 in his first full month in the big leagues this year, but just 214 during the month of June. Happy that the calendar has turned to July, and Castro is going to go out and try and fix whatever's wrong with Trachsel.
Joe, what you just said about the bottom of the order being weak is absolutely accurate. And to give you an idea about how precarious the plight of the Yankees is the Yankees are forced to win types of games like they won last night, a 2-0 game, five pitchers, Mike Messina going four innings, Ron Valone getting the win after working two, and then they turned it over to the bullpen. But their pitching's not strong enough to do that. And that's all the more reason why the Yankees and Joe Torre really deserve a lot of credit to be only three games behind the Boston Red Sox, who've won 12 of their last 13.
Say this, Traxel's not getting much off the corners either, and he's 2-0 now on Cabrera.
Six straight balls to open the second by Trachsel.
Seven.
I think you take two pitches here if you're Melky Cabrera. You take 3-0, of course, after seven straight balls, and then 3-1, too.
On the corner. Biggest thing that the injuries have forced the Yankees to do is deal with American League pitching in these games without two of their best run producers, and Hideki Matsui and Gary Sheffield, both of which haven't played since May. 3 balls and a strike on Cabrera. There's the list, courtesy of that person in the upper deck. There's another strike. He did take two, and it's a full count.
Well, you go on the theory that you're going to get the same pitch 3-2 that you got 3-1.
Trachsel comes back to pick up his second strikeout of the day. Back from a 3-0 count. Let's go to Jeannie Zelasco in the Fox Network Center.
We've got the Battle of Texas, the entire state on the line. It's a big one, and so is this double, courtesy Morgan Ensberg. Top one is 42nd RBI, makes it 1-0 Houston. On to Chicago for a check of the Ivy. Oh, yeah, it's there. Aramis Ramirez is using it. 2-run double. Cubs lead the White Sox 2-0, top three.
All right, Jeannie, if you look at the AL Central, Detroit has a 2.5 game lead over the White Sox. The Cubs have fallen out of it in the NL Central. There's a bunt foul by Crosby. And on the other side, talked about Houston. They are 6 games out, but they're 4 games under the 500 mark. But that's because the first place team, St. Louis, which is just 1 percentage point better than Cincinnati, has lost 9 of their last 10.
Even the Milwaukee Brewers are 4.5 back with a 500 record in the National League Central.
On 0-1, that's down and away. A ball and a strike on Crosby, who was on the DL with a pulled hamstring, so he's another guy that's been on the list. But he's back and getting the start today in right field and batting in the number 8 spot. Cairo next. And then you get into the dangerous territory of Damon, Jeter, and Giambi. I thought there was a time where Trachsel made it a point to try to hurry things a little bit, which is usually a good idea when you've got seven guys behind you trying to stay on their toes to make plays for you defensively. But this pace is just really slow.
Back in the early 60s, Bob Miller was a pitcher for the St. Louis Cardinals. He went on to become an outstanding reliever for the Los Angeles Dodgers. And the Dodgers, Ron Peronowski, he saw how Peronowski worked, and he learned from that and cut touching his uniform and his body something like 50 times between pitches. It was a nervous tick, a nervous habit. And he got out of it and became one of the top relievers of the 60s. You can improve yourself. It's like Sergio Garcia improving himself as far as pace is concerned and hitting a golf ball, which he has done.
2-2 is the count on Crosby. A leadoff walk, then a strikeout, and now another. Two down in the inning, Cairo coming up. Today's Burger King home field advantage, we give you a look at the faces of players and managers who have been a part of both the Yankees and the Mets. Stengel to Torrey to David Cone, Ricky Henderson, Al Leiter. Willie Randolph, who's now the manager after being a longtime coach on Joe Torre's staff. It's the Burger King Have It Your Way advantage. Ricky Henderson is here today and now one of the special instructors for Willie Randolph. And Cairo takes a strike. Pretty good resource for guys like Reyes and Wright, and Beltran and others who know how to run. Chavez for the Mets working with Ricky Henderson.
It's interesting to note that because you know how to run doesn't mean you know how to steal a base. It's a good start. He was the best.
You know, I was just looking at Omar Minaya. Of all the general managers in the National League that's looking to make a deal, there is nobody in a better position to do it than Minaya.
He might be making one right now.
Who's it going to be? Somebody tap into that call. But, I mean, he's got a double-digit lead in the division. He's got a couple of blue-chip minor league players in Lastings Millage and Mike Pelfrey. He's got the availability with payroll to add to this team, and there's no hurry to do it. Back after this from your local Fox station, 2-0 Mets. First pitch of the third inning was in for a strike to Jose Reyes. Top of the lineup for the Mets, LoDuca and Beltran will follow. 2-0. The Mets on top. Nasty pitch. The swing tells you all you need to know. 0-2.
That might be the worst swing as a right-handed batter that he's ever taken at the big league level. Watch this slider go down. Remember, on top of the ball. I think even Jose would laugh about that.
Out in front of that pitch. Ken Rosenthal is with us from FoxSports.com. Ken, this kid is just getting better and better and better, isn't he?
Mets bench coach Joe told Jerry Manuel told me before the game that Reyes has improved more than any young player he has ever seen from one season to the next. Manuel also said it's the hardest working young player he's seen since Marquise Grissom. This is a kid with a chance to finish with 20 doubles, 20 triples, and 20 homers this season. Only five players in history have done that, and only two since World War II.
Well, it's amazing, Ken, with the kind of speed that he has, that Jeter just turned in the play he turned in. That was sensational by Jeter.
Well, fortunately for the Yankees and Jeter, the ball was hit hard enough. But you're exactly right. Inside fastball, the jump, Jeter, the short hop, nicely done by Giambi.
That's that signature move that Jeter has made since he burst onto the big league scene in 96. the plant, the jump, turning in the air, and he really had to get everything behind that throw that he could to get it there in time to get Reyes. That was brilliant.
That was big time.
One out, nobody on. 0-1 is the count on LoDuca. But that's good to hear from Ken that you've got a guy like Reyes who's got the world by the tail now, starring in New York, drawing comparisons to Jeter, and yet Jerry Manuel will tell you he's one of the hardest working guys he's been around. That is good news for the Mets. One out, nobody on, no balls, two strikes on LoDuca, who set up the two-run first with a double. Still 0-2. You look at where the Mets are and where Reyes is using that speed as far as runs are concerned, triples. He's first in the big leagues with his 10 stolen bases. He leads the major leagues. It's a switch hitter with a little pop from each side and a fantastic throwing arm. 0-2. Still 0-2. A couple of years ago when Reyes was only 21 and just turning 21, the Mets had him over at second base when they were trying to use Kaz Matsui as their shortstop. Matsui had a terrible time trying to play shortstop. They finally flipped him back last year. And this year have gone so far as to trade Kaz Matsui to Colorado to pick up Marrero. And that was more just to get rid of Matsui.
Yeah, 2 years ago, the Mets were in a management slump. They didn't have Omar Minaya. They tried to move Katsui to shortstop and Reyes to second base. And they traded Scott Kazmir for Victor Zambrano. Zambrano, it's doubtful whether he'll ever pitch again. And Scott Kazmir could very easily be one of the all-star pitchers for the American League.
And I think Kazmir's 22 years old.
22 years old. So he could be the guy that the Mets are looking for right now. But they're not going to get him.
No.
No.
One of the few guys that the Devil Rays can hang their hat on. At the same time, they went after Chris Benson, who they let walk away over the offseason to the Baltimore Orioles, and he came back to bite him earlier this year, not only beating him in a start at Shea, but hitting a home run. 9 wins on the season. That's another typical type pitcher that Minaya is looking for. He's not necessarily looking for the front end of the rotation guy. He's got Glavin, he's got Pedro, two aging still stars in this league. But he needs a solid number three.
Yeah, you don't need a solid number three to win the division because the rest of the National League East is very, very poor. It's a poor division this year. But if you expect to make headway in the playoffs, you've got to have 3 good starters and a healthy, strong bullpen.
3 balls and a strike on Beltran. Kind of a clunker on the infield out behind second for Cairo and down in order. Go the Mets in this Battle of New York. Bottom of the third inning, top of the order for the Yankees. That means Damon, Jeter, and Giambi. Anybody gets on, Alex Rodriguez. Damon with a base hit up the middle his first time, takes a strike. Damon hitting .294. Production-wise, he has more home runs now than he hit last year with Boston. The RBI department, he's on pace for more than his 75 he had last year with the Red Sox. Like to get his average up, get on base a little more, but all in all, it's been a good first year with the pressure of playing for the Yankees. 1-1 pitch. Into left field, he's 2-for-2. So Damon has played for the Red Sox and the Yankees. Our Capital One trivia question is this. Showed you of all the players that have played for the Mets and the Yankees. What was the total, 97?
Yep.
Who's the first player to play for both the Mets and the Yankees? A Capital One trivia question. Here's Jeter, who singled his first time on a bang-bang play at first. When he got the call from first base umpire Tim McClellan when he looked out. Called safe. 2-0 Mets, bottom of the third, and a check on Damon, who has stolen 16, was out trying to steal third, although he was just on the move with Jeter on that 3-2 pitch to Giambi back in the first.
Kind of piqued my interest when you said that Chris Woodward was covering with Damon running and Jeter the hitter the first time. He'll be covering this time, too.
And Jeter dumps one into right. First two are on, and the Yankees have the same setup they had in the first. Two on, nobody out, and Giambi coming up.
For those of you who may not know what we're talking about, is Jeter singles the other way. A shortstop, the lead guy in the infield, will give an open mouth or a closed mouth to his second base partner with the glove up so the hitter can't see it. If the mouth is open, that means you cover. If it's closed, that means I've got it. We were surprised when Woodward was covering earlier, but had Damon run that last pitch, then Woodward would have been covering again. The reason for that is Jeter hit so many balls to right field, so had the shortstop cover.
Giambi now with a shift on the infield. Only two players on the left side of the diamond. David Wright, the third baseman for the Mets, and Johnny Damon, the runner at second for the Yankees. Big swing, strike one.
Like a breaking ball to Giambi. Giambi ahead, and the count knows a splitter. Took a detour getting there.
0-1 the count. Ball one. Tim mentioned that last year at this time he had 5 home runs. Since that time, at least July 4th, Giambi is tied in the top spot with 51 home runs. And there's a comparison to this point last year to what he's doing now. And look at the production difference. 63 RBIs compared to 22.
Generally speaking, if you slow down the pace, that means you don't have confidence in your stuff. When you work quickly, the hitter thinks that you think you can get him out. When you slow things down, that's not the case.
I was going to ask you last inning when we were talking about it. As a catcher, can you add that to your list of responsibilities to keep the pitcher on a better pace?
You hope to do that. There's more of a sequence of signs with the runner on at second base. A lot of that's overdone. But you just try to encourage him to work quicker.
2-1. 3-1.
I remember Juan Marichal used to run to the mound. And if I were leading off the inning, I would think, it's kind of retrospective thinking, why is he running out there? That means he thinks he could get me out.
He can't wait to face me.
He can't wait to face me.
Well, now Traxel's in trouble with two on. Nobody out. And a 3-1 count on Giambi. Now the bases are loaded. Three walks to go along with the four hits. And Alex Rodriguez up in a key spot here for the Yankees. Wednesday, 12th inning. Off Sosa, good night. Drive safely. Have a nice off day on Thursday. And exultation from A-Rod. This crowd has been on him hard over the past couple of weeks. Player of the month for the month of May. Hit in the low 200s for the month of June. And he comes up with the bases loaded and nobody out. And here are his thoughts on his recent struggles and the way the crowd has reacted to him here at Yankee Stadium.
You think you can't get caught up in his 1 month? I've played for 12 years, and people will take the month of June or May, and, you know, May I was player of the month. June, I had an awful June. Hopefully July will be better. But you can't look at a 12-year career and then look at 75 at-bats and say, oh, he's not clutch, or he's not this, or he's not that. Reverse that, and if you do have 7 or 8 game winners in a month of July, you can't say he's the most clutch player in the history of the game.
Well, here's his chance as the calendar is flipped to the 1st of July. Walked his first time. Strike one. Last 2 months, player of the month in May, hit .213 in June. Only 11 RBIs during the month, a number of opportunities. Had an RBI-less postseason last year for the Yankees. And the 0-1. The pitch was up to hit, and Rodriguez fouled it back 0-2.
What's that old Sinatra song? Riding high in April, shot down in May. Rodriguez in the hole.
There's still not one team in baseball that wouldn't, the deal were right, jump through 17 hoops to pick up Alex Rodriguez.
One of the top 50 players in the history of the game that has been booed lustily this season at Yankee Stadium.
And he rips a base hit into left field. One run will score. It's 2-1 as Alex Rodriguez puts the Yankees on the board. And now they're on their feet for Rodriguez here at Yankee Stadium.
An 0-2 cookie. That is a real, you hear that term a lot in the sequence of pitches. It seems like pitchers make mistakes, but hitters don't. But that was a mistake. To a great talent.
Here's Posada. Nobody out still. Bases loaded. One run game. Out in front of it. Strike one.
Fastball tailing away. When you're in a double play situation, normally the pitcher's going to try to keep the ball down. Unless he gets ahead, you can kind of eliminate anything above the belt.
Posada lined out hard to the track and right his first time. One ball, one strike. Jeter at third. Giambi at second and Rodriguez at first. Darren Oliver, the veteran left-hander, will get loose. Good pitch. 1-2.
Curveball totally freezes Posada. Good pitch.
So Trachsel now, with over 50 pitches thrown, is struggling to stay in this game. He had 2 strikes on Rodriguez and lost him. Double play ball to Woodward. Reyes in the middle. Tie game. Runner at third. 2 out. Jeter crosses the plate. The ball off the bat of Posada ties it. But not what he or the Yankees had in mind.
Trachsel comes back with a curveball. A lot of times that will fool a hitter, because in a double play situation, pitchers don't rely on this pitch. But Posada gets it, gets on top of it, and grounds it into an easy double play. Nicely turned by Woodward and Reyes.
Now it's Andy Phillips, who walked his first time with a go-ahead run at third, 2 out. 2-2. Ball one. Trachsel came up through the Cubs organization, was with the big league team from 93 to 99. Spent some time with Tampa Bay and Toronto. That was in 2000. He's been with the Mets since 2001. And his best year was 03, went 16-10 with a good ERA. Back troubles and now a free agent to be at the end of this season. 35-year-old right-hander. The guy at the top of the list with the most regular season starts without ever appearing in a postseason game. If he stays healthy, that should change this year. Phillips flies it into center. Carrying a long way, but caught by Beltran to end the inning. So two runs in the inning for the Yankees. They had hoped for more. 2-2 after three here in the Bronx. Fox Saturday Baseball, sponsored by Capital One. What's in your wallet? By the auto parts experts at AutoZone. Get in the zone, AutoZone. And by Burger King, who reminds you to have it your way. Another jam-packed house here at Yankee Stadium. Top of the fourth inning. 2-2 game now. Mets got the first two. Yankees got the last two. And Randy Johnson, who gave up two in the first, has now allowed the most first-inning runs in the major leagues this season among starting pitchers. But since that point, he's allowed 20 of them. For the rest of the game, up to date right now, 3.80 ERA. And he has thrown some nasty pitches the last two innings as he falls behind David Wright 2-0.
One thing he's done is he's used that split-finger fastball to his advantage this afternoon. Eight in a row retired by Johnson.
But he's 3-0 on Wright, whose two-run double in the first inning gives him 64 RBIs and at the time gave the Mets a two-zip lead. That wasn't close, a four-pitch walk. First walk of the game for Randy Johnson. Leadoff man is on. Our Capital One trivia question. Who was the first player to play for both the Mets and the Yankees?
Don Zimmer. No, Don Zimmer never played for the Yankees. Marvelous Marv from Memphis.
I would have had no chance at that.
I wouldn't have either. That's that last pitch by Randy Johnson. And the reason we're showing it to you, we thought it would be a pitch. That's the type pitch where a pitcher drops his hand down and kind of pushes the ball instead of a pitch like that where he throws it. Marvelous Marv.
So Thronberry the first to do it. 96 have followed, playing for both the Mets and the Yankees. Both managers have been a part of each organization.
The legendary story about Marv Thronberry was when he hit a ball, a gapper, at the old Polo Grounds. Casey Stengel came out to argue because Thronberry was called for missing second base. And he argued with the second base umpire. He said, don't argue, miss first too. So he missed first and second and ended up on third. True story.
Base hit. Franco is on. Wright will hold at second. It's two on with nobody out as Julio Franco adds to his 290 average.
Yeah, he gives in to Franco. Remember, we said the first time up, a ball that's down in the strike zone, and you can see how the hand drops down, the slider straightens out, and a line drive usually on the end of it. But Franco will pull that pitch, and that's about the only pitch he will pull, that ball down and in.
So now two on with nobody out. Back in that second inning, we saw a couple of Steve Carlton sliders from Randy Johnson. Mm-hmm.
The disappearing sliders.
Good chance here for the Mets. And a strike is into Xavier Nady. Got the Mets with Nady, an everyday outfielder. They have welcomed back Cliff Floyd from an injury rehab that sprained his ankle. Back on the active roster yesterday. There's Cliff. strike two. That forced Lasting's millage, their hot rookie, back down to the minor leagues. He actually put his arm around Omar Minaya on his way out the door yesterday, and the surplus in the outfield leads writers and broadcasters and call-in show callers to think that it will be one of the extra outfielders that's dealt for a pitcher by Minaya and the Mets. The 0-2. Good pitch. Nady wouldn't go after it, and Johnson didn't get the call. Ball one.
Good pitch in on the hands. Pardon me. In on the hands and off the plate. A good 0-2 pitch.
Runners on at first and second. Nobody out. That hit Nady, I believe, although the home plate umpire doesn't believe it. And Nady is going to argue. Here comes Willie Randolph.
Can almost hear that.
Yeah, you could.
I think it hit the front leg. Home plate umpire Jerry Davis says no. A similar slider that he threw to Franco. Oh, hit the back leg. Change directions. Hit him on the back shin.
Clearly hits Nady.
Clearly.
And that's the third instance in this game where a call could have gone either way. Another one that goes against the Mets. Jerry Davis thought it missed Nady. And instead of bases loaded, nobody out, it's a 2-2 count. And Nady strikes out, and Nady will have his final word. It won't matter. But Jerry Davis missed the call.
I think the best thing for an umpire in a situation like that is to judge the player. A player can't think quickly enough to go to first base if he wasn't hit.
Don't discriminate against players. A human being couldn't think fast enough.
No, human. Well, they're in uniform. Don't you do that. They're in uniform, so they're players. But that ball, clearly, there's no way that you go to first unless you were hit by the pitch. I almost said unless you was hit by the pitch. I think I did say that.
I heard that.
Tight jams, boy, your English goes. History. Adverbs.
One ball, one strike. We saw the pitch hit, Nady. Let's hear it.
You can hear it.
You can hear Nady.
We agree with you, Xavier.
The strikeout is the result, and now with two on, one out, Randy Johnson could get out of this. Woodward at the plate. He lined back to Randy Johnson his first time up. Good pitch. One and two.
A little extra pop on this fastball inside, right on the corner to Woodward.
You want to start a controversy?
Sure.
Okay. Our radar gun has him at 91. The Yankee Stadium radar gun has him at 96.
Radar gun favoritism here at Yankee Stadium.
Could be. The 1-2. Again, a good pitch, nasty down and in, and Woodward lays off. These have been much better pitches than the ones he started the inning with from Johnson.
Yeah, they're sharp. There's nothing rolling. Almost got Woodward to go for it, but good hold up by Chris.
A walk, a single, a strikeout. Carlos Delgado is bothered by a slight rib cage injury, and against the lefty, probably wouldn't have started anyway. On the bench again today. 2-2. That one said 97 on the scoreboard here, 94 on ours. And it's not to become Oliver Stone for you for a minute. That happens from different ballpark to different ballpark, with the television radar gun being different than the one that they flash on the scoreboard. But sometimes there's a little favoritism for the hometown guy. 2-2. It's when Traxel's throwing fastballs that register 76. Then we've got a controversy. Out to talk is Posada with this very important 2-2 pitch coming to Woodward.
Posada crossing the grassy knoll to the mound.
Fitting that a guy named Woodward would be at the plate. 2-2. Chris was a spare part player for the Blue Jays and a guy that's had a nice first year with the Mets.
He's done a very nice job. A lot of places he can play, and he has pop. Loves the high fastball.
Now a full count. He's had a good at bat. Full count with runners on at first and second, one out. We'll see how the Mets want to play this. Randy Johnson up to 60 pitches as he works here in the fourth.
I think you send the runners because you have the bottom part of the order up. If he were hitting the second hole, I wouldn't say send them, but I think you ought to send them right now.
Not going, and a check swing. He didn't go, and the bases are loaded.
What an at bat.
So two walks in the inning, a hit by pitch taken away, and here's the final pitch to Woodward.
And he did not go. A feisty at bat by Chris Woodward loads him up for the Mets.
And gives Castro a chance to put the Mets back on top. An eight pitch at bat with Woodward up. And Castro, who lined out his first time, and who has driven in eight runs, rips one into left field. The Mets are back on top. Two runs are going to come to the plate. The throw by Cabrera, not in time for two Mets.
A lot of young outfielders don't realize that if you hit the cutoff man, you give the catcher a good throw. If you overthrow the cutoff man, you short hop the catcher. Good hitting by Castro as the Mets retake the lead, but watch the throw by Cabrera. It's over Rodriguez's head, and it short hops Posada. So that's kind of a rule of thumb. If you hit the cutoff man, you give the catcher a good hop to handle.
Here's Eli Marrero, strike one, way out in front of that pitch. Eli not getting a ton of playing time with Colorado, and then the deal was made for Kaz Matsui. And Marrero, who came up as a catcher with St. Louis and can play just about anywhere, literally, is a bench player for Willie Randolph, getting the start. One ball, one strike. Former catcher and a guy who doesn't want to go back behind the plate anymore. He'll do it if need be, but that's not his preference. 1-1 pitch to third and foul, strike two. Good play.
Game of baseball contains so many things that are minutiae to some people, but that at bat by Chris Woodward, a huge at bat in this inning.
Johnson only has two strikeouts to go with his two walks. He has Marrero at 1-2. 2-2. There have only been a couple of fastballs that have really jumped out of the hand of Randy Johnson so far today. Still 2-2.
when the Yankees signed Randy Johnson last year, they had to guarantee the year 2007 at $16 million. So they have more than just this year in counting on Randy Johnson.
Full count. And after a long night for the bullpen last night for New York, after the rain delay and needing four to come out of the pen last night, the last thing Joe Torre wants to do is have to dip into his pen here in the fourth or fifth inning today. Marrero waits for a 3-2 pitch. Marrero is gone, second out, and may have chased ball four. I think that's the reaction of Eli Marrero, that he just gave Randy Johnson a break. Our AutoZone strike zone and a pitcher comparison between Trachsel and Johnson. Total pitches and strikes, and then first pitch strikes. And right now Johnson is trying to get through the fourth, and there's no doubt that was ball four, and Marrero chased it.
Yes, he did. Both high and away.
Two on, two out. Reyes in for a strike. Jose has singled and scored and grounded out. Working with Ricky Henderson, some of the finer points of base stealing. That's just up and away. One ball, one strike. How about that? Two outs and runners in scoring position. A 342 average. Over 100 points better than the league average for this 23-year-old.
Yeah, that's why he has a remarkable 36 RBIs. And we're not at the halfway point yet.
That is ripped into left. The pitch was up. The throw by Cabrera. They have a shot at the plate, but the throw is terrible. Woodward scores, and it's 5-2 Mets. Reyes delivers again. And not Melky only Cabrera airmailed home plate.
Yeah, not only is the throw high, but Randy Johnson wasn't backing up home. Another RBI with two outs by Reyes. And we talked about if you hit the cutoff man, you get a better hop for a catcher. By throwing it over a catcher's head, the hop is good for a guy sitting in the third row. No excuse for that.
The base hit is what started it. There is no error charged on the play. The runners both advancing on the throw home, I guess, is the official scorer's interpretation. So no error. It's an RBI single for Reyes, which was going to be either way. But it is not the second error of the season on Cabrera. And now LoDuca is up with a chance to make this a huge inning. Strike one.
After that slider down and in, Jose Reyes was halfway between second and third. You hear that often, the secondary lead. But that secondary lead, he was almost to third base.
One ball, one strike.
That's the big at bat by Chris Woodward once again that set this inning up.
At the time, it was two on with one out. He walked to load the bases. The hit by Castro drove home two. A two-out hit by Reyes, and now LoDuca grounds one through the left side. Melky Cabrera won't even throw this time. Two more runs at 7-2 Mets. And just when the Yankees start to get excited about the way Randy Johnson is throwing, he has a day like this.
is certainly not helping himself out. He walked the leadoff hitter on four pitches, David Wright, then the single, and then the plucky at bat by Woodward. And things have just become unraveled for the big unit. Reyes' speed, put it in your pocket. Just flies around the bases.
Remember a couple of years ago when he had all those hamstring problems and yeah. They were trying to teach him a different way to run?
Yeah.
How silly does that seem now?
The whole experiment about him moving to second and the reteaching him how to run seems so bizarre.
That led to not only hamstring issues, but a bad back.
Yeah.
TJ Beam getting loose. He can sit down for a moment as Beltran pops it into right. Nine men to the plate in the inning. In the fourth inning, a five-run fourth inning for the Mets, who lead it 7-2. 7-2. Fox Saturday Baseball, sponsored by Chevy, baseball's number one fan, Chevy and American Revolution. This game moves into the bottom of the fourth, and the bottom three in the lineup will come to the plate for the Yankees. And Randy Johnson is talking to himself over on the dugout bench after a nine-batter, five-run top of this fourth. We had a chance to talk with Willie Randolph moments ago. We'll try to get that on the air for you as Cabrera steps in. A strike over the outside corner. Melky struck out his first time. Oh, and two. You have to wonder, watching Cabrera, who is still in the category of just a baby. I mean, Melky is only 21 years old. Won't turn 22 until August. If it's starting to catch up to him a little bit, and while 3 weeks ago they were saying, well, he's okay to fill in the gap and play left field and fill in for Matsui, if at some point they're not going to have to find somebody else with a little more experience to play out there.
And it's a lot different too, Joe, when you're breaking in a 21-year-old with the Yankees as opposed to the New York Mets. You look at 2 years ago, you talk about Reyes and Wright, both 21 years old, but they weren't expected to win. The Yankees are, and there's a big difference in that.
He's on with a base hit, so that has to feel good after a month of June where he hit only 214. He's on to start the fourth, and here's our chat with Willie Randolph. Well, Willie Randolph, I know there's a lot for you to deal with during these three games, interleague play, and today's more like it. Man, your team is a fun team to watch, and that Reyes has been right in the middle of it all day today.
Yes, it is a fun team to watch, and Jose's been on a nice little rhythm. Last couple of days, he struggled a little bit, but when he goes, we go, man. He's an exciting player.
And you combine that with Wright and everything that you've got going, you know better than I the way this city is.
Yes.
How worried have you been during this four-game losing streak? I would imagine not very worried.
No, it's a little glitch in the situation here. But you know what? This team's played consistently well all year long. You know, you're going to go through a little up and down every once in a while. But the big thing about this club is that we rebound real well. We bounce back. And, every once in a while, you're going to go through those types of situations. But, we have a good thing going here. We're going to keep it going.
Thanks for your time.
Okay, guys.
Willie Randolph, and very nearly a double play turned by Woodward and Reyes. They did all they could. The ball just wasn't hit sharply enough. So Crosby is on the 4-6 force out. And there aren't many shortstops in baseball that have a stronger throwing arm than Jose Reyes.
Flat-footed. Flat-footed and behind the bag.
One on, one out for Cairo. Yankees need something to try and climb back into this game. It's 7-2 in the fourth. Strike one. Cairo is playing for the injured Robinson Cano, who went down with a slight tear in his left hamstring. They had to put him on the disabled list, and when he went on the list, he had the highest batting average among all American League second basemen.
leading vote getter in the All-Star game that once again will be played a week from Tuesday night in Pittsburgh.
Yankees will go on a road trip, and Cano will head down to Tampa to rehabilitate that left leg. Oh, and 2 is the count on Cairo at this point. The leading vote getters in the American League: Ramirez, Suzuki, and Vladimir Guerrero. A-Rod, Jeter, Cano, Ortiz, and Veritek.
Interesting to note that so far, 12 of the 16 starters, the regular players, are from the Eastern divisions of the American and National Leagues.
Guerrero and Suzuki are the exceptions on the AL side. But the Mets at this point are well represented. One on, one out, no balls, two strikes. That skips in there, and that will allow Crosby to go down to second on a wild pitch. On the National League side, Reyes, Wright, LoDuca, and Beltran. Four of the starters, Mets, with Pujols, Utley, Jason Bay of the hometown Pirates, and Alfonso Soriano out in left. The American League has not lost the All-Star game in 10 years. And their dominance over the National League has never been more obvious than what we're witnessing so far this season during interleague play. It is so far the superior league right now, for whatever reason. It's hard to explain why, if it's cyclical or whatever, but the AL is a better league without a doubt.
I think one of the reasons is that the American League, on the bottom of the order, they're 7 through 9 hitters. They're geared to hit. Whereas in the National League, you have those guys, one is going to be a pitcher, and the other two are in there primarily for defense. If you're hitting 7th or 8th in the National League, generally, you're not a good hitter. You can be hitting 7th or 8th in the American League and be a good run producer.
American League leads the World Series 6-3 since 97. There's the All-Star game totals. And Interleague, 139-85 this season. The Mets lead here today over the Yankees 7-2. The 2-2. Cairo grounds to David Wright. Two out, runner at second. Damon coming up, and Jeannie Zalasco with a game break.
And we are trying to find that Cubs silver lining. How about Ramon Ramirez earning his paycheck at Wrigley? A 2-run home run in the 5th. He already has a double, a triple. He's a single away from the cycle. It's 5-3 Cubs until Joe Creedy does this in the top of the 6th. Home run, the White Sox clawing back 5-4, top 6 Cubs.
All right, Jeannie. We talked about it an hour and a half ago during our open, that when you consider what's going on in the AL Central between Detroit and the White Sox, and Detroit, it's like they're definitely for real. In the American League East, it looks like, at least at this point, you're going to have to win your division to get into the postseason. There's no soft landing on a wild card out there for the Red Sox or Yankees. Strike one on Damon, who's 2-for-2.
You can even take that one team further in the American League Central. The Minnesota Twins have played the hottest brand of baseball over the last 2.5 weeks, 16-1. And they've gained a game on the Tigers and 2 games on the White Sox. That graphic just blows me away.
They're the Twins, 16 out of 17, but the Tigers during that stretch won 15 and the White Sox 14. And there's a look at the AL Central. Most wins in the big leagues belong to the Tigers. That is down the left field line, foul. Strike two on Damon. Ken Rosenthal, you're smarter than both of us, maybe combined. Can you tell us why the American League is so much better than the National League?
First of all, Joe, I am not smarter than both of you combined. And second of all, no one seems to have the answer. I think what Tim said about the 7-9 hitters in the order is a very strong point. There is some thought also that the Yankees and Red Sox dominance in recent years has forced other teams to come up. The Blue Jays are a good example of that. They spent some money now. The Tigers are on the rise, and so, of course, the White Sox have been a very good team for 2 years now.
One ball, two strikes on Damon. And another foul. And hearing the voice of Ken Rosenthal certainly reminds us something that we've talked about so much since we all gathered here today at Yankee Stadium as a group with Fox, and sending our get well wishes to not just Peter Gammons, but thoughts and prayers for his entire family suffering a brain aneurysm Tuesday morning in Cape Cod. And on his way back in stable condition, but he has a fight ahead of him, and we're all pulling for him. Into shallow right, out goes Woodward to make the catch, and the Yankees put their leadoff man on. Strand their fifth. Happy 4th of July weekend, everybody. 7-2 Mets. David Wright has been a part of both Mets rallies. Takes a breaking ball in for a strike from Randy Johnson. A two-run double in the first, a walk and a run scored in the fourth. 7-2 Mets in the fifth. One ball, one strike. Two and one. Mets are here after spending 3 days in Boston. A reunion of the two teams that met the 1986 World Series. And here in 2006, they are each leading their own division and playing very good baseball. Will it be a 20-year reunion in October? However, riding a four-game losing streak today, 7 runs compared to the 8 they scored the last 4. 3-2 now on right.
Joe, you and I talked about it last weekend, how the Red Sox have made so many moves during the offseason. Mark Loretta, Alex Gonzalez, Mike Lowell, to name 3, Kevin Youkilis going from 3rd to 1st, Coco Crisp in center field.
There's a leadoff walk from Randy Johnson.
You have a rookie as a short reliever, and to have done what they've done and to be as overpowering as they've been in recent years is a tribute to their management team.
Pulled off the Josh Beckett trade.
Yeah.
Had to give up a good one in Hanley Ramirez to get him, but it appears worth it. 12-1 over their last 13 games. And right now, even with all that said, all the injuries the Yankees have endured, they're only 3 games out, the Yankees are, at the start of the day. That is a credit, as you said at the top, Tim, to the job that Joe Torre and this Yankee team has done here in the first 2.5 months of the season. TJ Beam getting loose again.
Even earning the admiration of the Boston Red Sox. They've said it several times.
One ball, one strike from Randy Johnson to Julio Franco. He singled and scored his last time up. Strike 2. Mentioned 1982 when Julio made his major league debut for the Phillies. $1.30 for a gallon of gas. Ah, those were the days, Timmy.
Oh, man.
Joe Torre wins a division title with the Braves, and Rosanna, a theme song for many in our audience for their youth, was the number one song by Toto.
We were trying to figure out in the trucks before the game what the dance craze was in 1982. I think it was a couple of years after the Hustle.
It was post-Hustle.
The post-Hustle. PH.
Franco can still get after that high fastball. It's 1-2. David Wright on that graphic, Jose Reyes, they were not even born when Julio Franco was making his major league debut with the Phillies. Only to be traded in that deal for Von Hayes and make his name with the Indians. I don't know what the dance craze was, Tim, but I know you were wearing a piano tie.
I used to love to do the hustle.
Oh.
Now I still do the hustle, but the music's, you know, right, like 25 years late.
It's tough to do the hustle to 50 Cent. One and two on Franco with right at first on base for the third time today.
Can't do the hustle to rap music. No, no, no.
Johnson, out of frustration, fires it over to first base. Wright has stolen 11 bases. That's part of his attack, 11 out of 13. To go along with the run production and his steady play over at third. There goes Wright. Swing and a miss for the out. Throw down. Double play.
Great throw by Posada.
And even Randy Johnson even acknowledged it, pointing back to Posada as he cuts down Wright.
It's so hard to throw with the count 3-2 because you have to stay back hoping to get the strike. And what a strike that was as Cairo popped Wright right on the helmet for the out. Strike him out. Throw him out. Fine throw by Posada.
Ball one up and into Nady. Nady hit by a pitch his last time up. Didn't get the call from the home plate umpire and then struck out. 0 for 2. One ball, one strike. Ron Guidry, the pitching coach for Joe Torre now. Hoping that Randy Johnson can get through the fifth. They've had TJ Beam up twice in a 37-pitch fourth inning and already here in the fifth after the leadoff walk. That's where Posada called for it. 2-2. Got him looking. Halfway through it. Bono, it's all yours. Fox Saturday Baseball, sponsored by Goodyear's new Eagle with Response Edge technology. By WebMD, better information, better health. And by Subway Restaurants. Subway, eat fresh. Yankees bat, bottom of the fifth. 2, 3, and 4 hitters. Jeter takes a ball. He's 2 for 2 with a pair of singles and a run scored. Hitting 338. Trachsel is getting his typical run support as he gets Jeter on a breaking ball to ground a short, one out. Joe Torre, in his 11th year as manager of the New York Yankees, chatted with us during the last break. Well, Joe Torre, you've had TJ Beam up a couple of times in your bullpen today. What are you seeing down there from Randy Johnson so far this afternoon?
Well, the thing I see, it doesn't look like he has as good a command as last time out. He's throwing the ball good and he's making some good pitches. But to me, he's just missing on some. He got a lot of check swings that, didn't go our way. Not that we're complaining, but, he's that close around the zone. But they haven't good at-bats against him.
If you had to point to one reason why, despite all the injuries and despite the way the Red Sox are playing, you guys are still hanging in there in the AL East, who or what would it be?
Well, it has to be our pitching because they keep us close. Today is an unusual game for us. And I have to credit, the starting pitching, basically. I think Wong more than anybody else for someone you really shouldn't be able to count on. And right now, we really trust him a great deal.
And once you get to the All-Star break, that's kind of the time for you guys to start thinking about getting healthy, right?
Well, I think, you know, we can start looking for Pavano and Dotel and those guys, which can only help our bullpen.
All right, Joe, thanks for the time.
Okay.
Another name on that list would be Robinson Cano, who is going to start shortly working his way back from the tear in his left hamstring. And there's Pavano, who hasn't pitched for over one calendar year. Signed to a $40 million deal leading into last year. And he has had shoulder, back, elbow issues. And it's been frustrating, to say the least, not only for Carl, but for this Yankee team and their fans. That's a walk on a 3-1 pitch low to Giambi here in the fifth. Dotel was on the fast track back, and then he developed tendonitis in his pitching elbow. Took a cortisone injection in there, and he hopes to get on the mound middle of next week. And he's about a month away.
Yeah, since 1996, Joe Torre certainly has had the Midas touch with these Yankees. And what he would like right now with the roster and the shambles that it's in is to have a Sears touch. Somebody who could be a cure-all for this ball club. They are banged up. Every team has to deal with it, but the Yankees this year, more than their share.
Initially, they said that Matsui would be out for the year. He believes he can come back in August. The team hopes in September. And about the same time for Sheffield at best, who had surgery on the wrist. But those are two huge holes that the Yankees have not been able to fill. 1-0 pitch. That's down the right field line, slicing foul. And out of play. One ball, one strike. Rodriguez has walked and singled home a run back in the third to put the Yankees on the board. They had a chance for more, couldn't come up with a big hit, and here are the two guys they're missing. Matsui went down with a fractured wrist May 11th. Sheffield hasn't played since the 29th of May. The Yankees are 26-19 since either one of those two's been in the lineup. That's going to be a tough play for Wright. Bare hand, pick up, and throw for the out. Good play on both ends.
That's big time right there for David Wright, because you have to play Alex Rodriguez deep to begin with. So he's got farther to go. Bare hand. And the in-between hop, and you're right, Franco with a fine play on the other end. I'll tell you, that's a play by a third baseman, Joe, that used to be an exception by the greats, by Mike Schmidt, Brooks Robinson, the best in the game, Bobby Gritch, when he played third base. But now third basemen are making those, I won't say routinely, but they're making them much more numerously than they have in the past.
Well, you've got some guys on the list now that are regarded as the best defensive third baseman in each league that I think their respective managers wouldn't feel bad about putting them if they had to at shortstop. And that's happened with Troy Gloss. As Trachsel changes up on Posada, strike one. Gloss has done that during interleague play to get he and Hillenbrand in the lineup.
Of course, Gloss signed as a shortstop with the Angels. Good splitter from Trachsel.
0-1 is the count on Posada. Yankees need a blast. Posada on the year has hit 10 home runs. Giambi at second, two down, and that's down the left field line and out of play. Strike two. It looked like in the third the Trachsel might not get through five this afternoon, and he is one good pitch away from doing just that with a five-run lead.
It's funny how you look back over a game thus far. It's the double play into which Posada hit in that third inning with the bases loaded, nobody out, and the at-bat by Chris Woodward sandwiched in between that five-run inning for the Mets.
Ball one high. Interesting, as I look up at the scoreboard, that our radar gun is at most 1 mile per hour off when the Mets are on the mound and 3 or 4 when the Yankees are on the mound. Two balls, two strikes on Posada. Maybe they have a home and away gun. Posada gets underneath it into right field for Nady, and he has room. A walk in the inning, the sixth stranded on the day by the Yankees. We go to the sixth, 7-2 Mets. Randy Johnson will work in the sixth. It's 7-2, the Mets out in front. Posada flashes the signs, and Randy Johnson brings it home to Woodward. Strike one, our Avidart in-game box score for the Mets. Reyes right in the thick of it, and certainly the same for David Wright. Big two-run hit by Castro, the number 8 hitter. Khalil Franco has a single and a run scored. And LoDuca's had a nice day with a double, a run scored, a single, and two RBIs. 0-2 on Woodward. With three pitches, Woodward is gone. One out here in the sixth inning. Tonight, NASCAR on Fox returns with Nextel Cup Racing from Daytona. The world's best drivers take the track as defending champion Tony Stewart looks to defend his title on NASCAR's most famous track, the Pepsi 400, tonight at 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific, and high def only on Fox.
Here our pal, Darrell Waltrip.
With one down, here is a ball. Johnson didn't think so, to Ramon Castro. Six strikeouts now for Randy Johnson. Didn't you and Darrell do that?
We did.
That golf event together?
Yeah.
The Super Bowl pregame?
Before the Super Bowl pregame, or as part of the Super Bowl pregame a couple of years ago in Ponte Vedra, Florida. He was more fun to work with. Great guy.
Than who?
You quit it.
2-0 with a count on Castro, now 2-1. Castro's lined back to Randy Johnson and singled home two and scored a run.
I wasn't comparing that. I was just saying he was so much fun to work with. Period. Not than anybody.
Two balls, two strikes on Castro.
Oh.
I'm just kidding you.
Oh, I know that.
Castro now and Marrero on deck. Full count. Joe Torre with one of his experienced members of his coaching staff, Lee Mazzilli, who's now the bench coach. Was the first base coach here, bench coach, managed the Orioles, and now is back next to Joe Torre. That's on the inside corner. Castro is gone. Seven strikeouts, and here is Jeannie Zelasco.
Well, the Cubs went to the bullpen. The White Sox to a pinch hitter. Scott Ayer, meet Paul Konerko. That went well for the White Sox. Tie ball game, 5 apiece, top 7, and a hot day at Arlington. So is Mike Lamb. How about the 3-run double here? He's got a double, a triple, a homer, and like Aramis Ramirez, a single away from the cycle. Where's it now?
So two developing cycles in other spots on Fox Saturday Baseball. And here a ball to Eli Marrero. Randy Johnson has struck out the last four batters he's faced. 1-1.
How unusual is that to have the three toughest hits on your way to a cycle. Double, triple, home run.
Astros right now just need to win a game. Marrero clubs one down the left field line. Will it stay fair? It is gone for a home run for Eli Marrero. And it's 8-2 Mets here in the sixth inning.
Talk about a guy looking for a pitch and he got it.
16th home run allowed this season by Randy Johnson, and the only question was whether it would stay fair or not.
Look at how he opens up looking for the slider, hitting it right on the sweet part and just staying fair. See how he gave a little bit on that front side looking for the pitch that he got, and boy did he ever hammer it.
Reyes off balance fouls it back and Posada gives it a chase. One ball, one strike.
We've seen a lot of those flat pitches today from Randy Johnson. You remember the scouting report? He's on top of the ball. He's on top of the game. That was a flat slider. And big league hitters hammer those pitches, and that's what happened off the bat of Eli Marrero. Oof.
Here comes a 1-1 to Reyes. Off the fists and fouled for strike two. Well, you can see it walking around town. The Yankees have everything to be proud of, and their fans certainly are with their great history. But with what's gone on this season, you see a lot more Mets hats around Manhattan. The Met fans are having a ball here at Yankee Stadium today and getting louder as we go. Reyes flies to right. We go to the bottom of the sixth inning here at Yankee Stadium. They haven't stopped. Two in the first, five in the fourth, one more in the sixth, and an 8-2 Mets lead. Mets have won 8 of the last 13 games they've played against the Yankees. And during that stretch, the Mets have out-homered the Yankees 23-7.
Man.
Over the last 13 plus games between these two. 8-2 now, the Mets on top, and Traxel's back for the sixth. He misses high, one ball, one strike. The Mets have to be thrilled, even in a losing cause last night, of the work and effort they got out of LoDuca. Orlando Hernandez, who is a big game pitcher, there is no doubt about it. Tricky hop for Reyes. Phillips is gone. There is LoDuca last night, 7 innings, 2 runs, 7 hits, 3 strikeouts and a walk. And to shift topics and bring in Ken Rosenthal. Ken, we heard Joe Torre say that the most valuable part of the team so far has been the pitching. What do you think their priority is as they look to add to this club at the trading deadline?
Early on, Joe, it was pitching. They were talking about going out and getting another starter, especially when Johnson was struggling. That need is still there, but the need for offense is becoming increasingly clear. They were next to last in the American League in runs in June, and there are scouts and executives who believe that Phillips and Cabrera are really extra players on a championship club. So they could look for the bat, they could look for the starter, and because Octavio Dotel is coming off Tommy John surgery, they might need a reliever as well.
Off the fists and into the air, and now the glove of Julio Franco for out number two. The question is, Ken, who do they have to trade? They've got a young starter that they love. What's his name, Hughes?
Yes, Philip Hughes. He is their top prospect. They don't want to trade him. I don't think they would trade him in a deal except for perhaps Dontrelle Willis. That's a kind of young guy that they could get back. That would be the only way they would trade Philip Hughes. That's the only way, by the way, that the Mets would trade Lasting's Millage for Dontrelle Willis. But the Yankees farm system is better than it's been in recent years. They've got two rookies in the bullpen up right now, TJ Beam and Matt Smith, and they've got some other parts that teams like. Jim Bowden, the Nationals GM, was asked about their system and how dry it was, and he said, well, it's wet enough for me.
That's interesting. Since he controls the future and at least the immediate destiny of Alfonso Soriano. Is he still in play, you think?
He is absolutely in play, but I don't think the Yankees want to invest their major chips on a hitter. I think ultimately, Joe, they're going to need pitching. And you look at them right now, and you try to construct a postseason rotation. It's not easy to do.
Ground ball to the second baseman. The Yankees go down quietly in the sixth inning. That sends us to the seventh. Seventh inning at Yankee Stadium. Mets having fun up 8-2. Back after this from your local Fox station. ...25-year-old T.J. Beam, one of the young relievers that Ken Rosenthal was just talking about, takes over here in the seventh inning. 8-2, the Mets out in front. Randy Johnson is on the hook for the loss. He went six, allowed eight runs on eight hits, struck out seven, walked three, allowed a home run to Marrero last inning. And here's LoDuca, who was part of the problem for Randy Johnson. A double, a run scored, and a two-run single. Playing with a bruised thumb, he takes a ball outside. The DH today. At least Randy Johnson gave the Yankees six innings. Didn't have his best stuff, but worked through six to try to take some of the load off this bullpen. One ball, one strike.
Paulo Duca with a bruised left thumb, which means that it will have little time to heal as a regular catcher. So the Mets playing interleague, they can afford to have LoDuca as the designated hitter and rest his legs and his sore thumb.
Up and in from Beam. It's 2-1.
Guy like Ramon Castro, invaluable as the backup catcher. One of the toughest commodities in baseball now is a backup catcher. A good one.
That's into left field. Another hit for LoDuca. Bad thumb and all. His answer to how is your thumb feeling was it's manageable, and he is on with his third hit of the day.
Fielder Carlos Beltran.
Fastball. Posada wanted the pitch away. It's tailed back inside, and LoDuca with his third hit of the day.
Now Beltran is hitless, with two pop-ups and a fly out to right. That was batting right-handed. Takes a ball outside. That's down and away, 2-0. Ken Rosenthal, do you have any dark horse picks to enter the possible pitching trade market? We always hear Dontrell Willis, but are there any other frontline guys that might sneak onto that list that could end up with some team like the Mets?
Joe, I don't think the Giants are going to trade Jason Schmidt. They're still in contention. And Barry Zito is a guy that the A's will trade, but only if they get the right offer in return. And earlier in the season, there was some thought of a Lastings Millage Aaron Hauman package. But that's too much for Zito, who's a free agent at the end of the year. Unless you're sure you can sign him, I don't know that you can have that certainty.
Ken, what about Johan Santana of Minnesota?
He signed long-term, Tim. And what's interesting in the last few years is that a lot of the lower revenue teams have kept their pitchers and signed them to extensions. Santana's an example of that. Roy Oswalt in Houston, CC Sabathia in Cleveland, Ben Sheets in Milwaukee. That's one reason why the trade market and the free agent market is not as plentiful as it used to be.
One on, one out. Wright takes a strike.
Just because he's signed to a long-term contract doesn't mean that he's not tradable and a tradable commodity, right?
That's true, Tim. But Johan Santana, as we both know, is probably going to be the starting pitcher in the All-Star game for the American League, and he is one of the bright lights in the game right now. And combine him with Francisco Liriano, you've got the most dynamic left-handed combination in the game.
0-2 now on David Wright from Beam.
Yeah, once again, the Minnesota Twins, 16 of their last 17 games they have won, and there's a dynamic duo for Minnesota. What can they pitch? Ooh. Liriano coming to the Twins from the San Francisco Giants in the A.J. Pierzynski trade.
Double play to end the inning. Wright hit it hard, but right at Phillips. Three unassisted. Time to stretch here at Yankee Stadium. Yankees come to the plate, down by six. Fox Saturday Baseball, sponsored by Flomax, by Holiday Inn, the official hotel of Major League Baseball, and by GMC, engineered to the highest standard, professional grade. Inside Yankee Stadium, our Flomax game summary. Wright and Reyes, that 23-year-old dynamic combination, 3-for-6, 3 RBIs, 3 runs scored. Mets four-game losing streak. They brought in, looking like that may end today, and Randy Johnson, 14 earned runs and 11 innings pitched this year against the Mets. Here's Randy's day today. Six, allowed 8 runs on 8 hits. Gave way to TJ Beam, and Steve Trachsel is back out there for number 7. Aaron Heilman is getting loose, one of their talented young right-handers. Product of Notre Dame and early in the season. Because of injury, when the Mets were looking for another starter before they got LoDuca, fans were calling for Heilman to go into the rotation, but Omar Minaya wanted to keep him right there setting up Billy Wagner.
It's a gutty performance by Trachsel this afternoon. A lot of pitchers thinking that the road to a win is paved with gold is just not true. I mean, most of the time, you can look back over a W and say, what was the inning that I had to rise to the occasion, not being cliche-ish, but it was that third inning with the bases loaded, nobody out, and he enticed the double play ball from Posada, and that's why he's ahead 8-2.
Cairo first up, 9-1-2 for the Yankees. Johnny Damon and Derek Jeter will be next. Heilman getting loose in case there are any hiccups in the inning for Trachsel. Pitch number 99 coming from Trachsel. 1-1. Cairo is grounded out twice. One and two. Yankees and Mets playing here while the Red Sox and Marlins will continue their series. Last night, the Marlins behind Dontrell Willis beat Boston to end their 12-game winning streak.
Joe, when Ken Rosenthal was talking the last inning, I couldn't help but think about this being the time of year when every team drives up the market for the players that they're trying to trade. And a lot of people think that perhaps Lasting's Millage could be one of those guys that the Mets are really not sure whether he fits into their picture in the future or not. I mean, the Dodgers for years were like that, inflating the value of minor league players to entice other teams to trade for them, and then they trade for them and find out that those players aren't as good as they thought they were.
That's down and in. Cairo trying to get on base has a full count. 24 games, he hit 233, got off to a slow start, got hot, and then tapered off, and now he is back in the minor leagues, off the active roster when the Mets put Cliff Floyd back on the 25-man group. 3 balls, 2 strikes on Cairo. Back up the middle. Trachsel knocks it down and turned it into a hit.
He did turn into a hit because had that ball gotten by him, Reyes sucks it up. Just enough of the web, and then Steve trips going after it. So an infield hit for Cairo.
There are viewers, I'm sure, who have been through a herniated disc in their back, as Trachsel has. And now as I say that, here comes the trainer. And what I was going to say was that little extra motion when he initially went after it, he lost his footing going up the mound and then was a little gimpy after picking up the baseball. That area of your low back becomes so weakened, and you have to build it up, which he has. It's right there, that little extra grab, and he then ended up with a little limp, and they're going to take him out either way. So there's no way of telling at this point if they're taking him out just to be cautious with a six-run lead, or if there is something wrong with Trachsel after that ball back up the middle. But he's gone. Heilman is in. Pitching change in the Bronx. Rick Peterson, the pitching coach, and Paul LoDuca, his regular catcher, is the DH today, able to go over and talk to Trachsel in the reaction. Let you know that he's feeling okay after that play behind the mound. In fact, a moment ago, you could see him mouthing, "I'm fine," and they're not even looking at him in the dugout. So up over 100 pitches, a six-run lead in the seventh. He's taken out in favor of Aaron Heilman, a very good right-hander. Numbers wouldn't lead you to believe that, but he's got very good stuff. Top of the order. Yankees trying to climb back in it. Damon, strike one. Johnny is two out of three.
Aaron Heilman, one of the few young pitchers right off the campus of Notre Dame, as you said, Joe, with a good changeup. Normally, changeups are developed in the major leagues, and few college pitchers have those pitches when they come off the campus, but Heilman did, and it's an excellent, and that was it right there.
One ball, one strike. Great body and arm action on the changeup, and then the velocity is just not there. Another changeup, 83 miles an hour, and Damon fouls it, strike two.
I think what that changeup gives Heilman is a way and the ability to neutralize the left-handed hitter. When the leg goes up, foot comes down, the ball's not there.
Cairo takes off, a chance for Castro, and too late. Stolen base, down by six runs. That just tells you the Yankees believe anybody can run on Heilman, and he's slow to the plate.
Yeah, because he certainly ran on Heilman and not on Castro. Close play, adventurous play. You got to love it.
But if he's going to go down by six in the seventh inning, he better make it.
All the time.
Laid off that 80 mile an hour change, and it's a full count. This is a member of the top bullpen in the National League and the major leagues, 3.18 ERA. That's low, a hit, a stolen base, a walk, and the Yankees and their fans hoping that they are smelling a rally.
Yeah, a glimmer of hope with the meat of the order coming up. Nobody out.
Here's Jeter. He's also two for three. So Heilman comes out of the bullpen and walks the first man he faces. Damon did a good job of laying off some tantalizing pitches. And Jeter hitting 337. Strike one. 80-mile-an-hour changeup, 94-mile-an-hour fastball.
Pitchers put balls there. Every pitch, hitters would be out of work.
One ball, one strike. Trachsel, six plus innings as a starter. Now Heilman, strike two. If Heilman had his pick, he would be in the starting rotation, but he does not have his pick. So he's part of the group setting up Billy Wagner. Two and two.
That's what pitchers try to do. You can even see Castro standing up to receive that high fastball.
Two on with nobody out. Two balls, two strikes on Jeter. Three and two. Now the Yankee fans climb back in it. Double play ball. Reyes steps and fires, two out. And the Met fans take over with a cheering on the 6-3 double play off the bat of Jeter.
When you're trailing by six, you can't send the runners. You send the runner, no double play. As it was, easy double play.
And our Pepsi double play turned by Reyes. And now it's a runner at third, two down. Ground ball led Reyes right to the bag, and here is Giambi with two out. Hard hit right at Franco to the bag, and that'll do it for the Yankees in the seventh. Look promising. Two on, nobody out. Jeter up with a full count, and the Yankees come up empty and still trail by six after seven. For our Pepsi fan cam, George Thorogood asked the fans here, who do you love? Julio Franco not wanting to wait around to find out what the left-hander Matt Smith, 27-year-old, who takes over here, third pitcher of the day, kind of stuff he has. He goes after the first pitch, strike one. One of three left-handers the Yankees have in their bullpen with Vallone and Mike Myers, the other two. One ball, one strike. Skips in there to Posada, 2-1.
Past years, you used to see the Yankees bring up an occasional young starter, Ted Lilly, they brought up. We did that game. Brandon Clausen, who's now with Cincinnati. There has been such an influx of young pitchers from the Yankee minor league system as relievers this year, like no other year in Joe Torre's tenure here with the Yankees.
How about your favorite over the years, Arabu?
Hideki Arabu.
Three balls and a strike. Well hit into right field. It'll carry, but not out of here. Back to the track and caught by Crosby. Whatever happened to Hideki Arabu?
I know the last I heard of him, he was with Montreal prior to their move to the nation's capital. I don't know.
And I think he went back and pitched in Japan for a little while.
Yeah, I think that's right.
But that one didn't quite pan out for the Yankees.
No.
With one out, nobody on. Batter is Nady, and he takes a ball. T.J. Beam went one inning, allowed one hit. Nady is hitless on the day with two strikeouts. To the shortstop, Jeter comes up. Two down.
Second baseman, Chris Woodward.
Hey, Ken Rosenthal, how do you read the Lastings millage situation? Take Dontrell Willis out of the mix and tell me where you think he fits in the long-term future with this Mets team.
I think he is part of the Mets long-term. And when you look at the young core that they've assembled, Wright and Reyes, and even Beltran fits into that mold, Lastings Millage will be the next guy in that group. Cliff Floyd is a free agent after this season. They could re-sign him, but Lastings Millage could easily fit into that left field role.
Do you see any teams that would have interest in Cliff Floyd if the Mets decided to go that way, or Nady for that matter?
I think teams would definitely have interest in Cliff Floyd, especially those that need a left-handed hitter like the Tigers. But the Mets also see Floyd as a valuable part of their team as they try to win a World Series. He gives them that American League type depth in their lineup with Delgado and Wright and Reyes and Beltran. It makes that lineup that much deeper. He's also great in the clubhouse, and that's another reason they like him.
And a good friend of David Wright, who we're seeing on our screen right now. Two out, nobody on, 0-2 the count, and that gets in there. They have a nice relationship, don't they, Ken?
Yes. Floyd has been almost like a mentor to Wright, and he's that way with a lot of guys in the clubhouse. He's kind of a ray of light, and that is invaluable for a team. The Mets have a very good chemistry going, a very good mix of youth and veterans, and they think that Floyd can be a big part of that, but most of all, they want his bat to get going. They feel that when it's going, their lineup is really deep.
Two and two.
You don't need a guy like Cliff Floyd when things are going well like they have for the Mets the first 3 months of the season, but you do need him now after a four-game tailspin.
Base is empty, two down, two balls, two strikes on Woodward. That's fouled. Ken, Woodward is playing second base today. They're trying to get by with Woodward and Valentin. That's another spot where they could look. Second base, Ken.
And Joe, what he's told me, Omar Minaya did, was that second base is not a priority. Now, they have been talking to the Devil Rays on and off about Julio Lugo. Right now, there's no match. It would take a three-way to get it done, but I think all their chips are going to go into pitching. That's their biggest need right now.
Don't scare me like that, Ken. You didn't answer right away. I thought, where are you, by the way?
Short of battery again.
Where are you?
I am down by the Yankees dugout along the first baseline. And it was a technical thing, Joe.
Again?
I guess.
Our friends at NHK have told us that Arabu has retired and is living in California. Here's a 2-2. Woodward. So Arabu's out there, Ken Rosenthal. You think any teams would want him?
I think teams are going to pass on Hideki.
That's why you're here, to give us the inside dirt, the inside scoop, as only Ken Rosenthal can do. 8-2 Mets. Fox Saturday Baseball, sponsored by Pepsi Complete. Turn a fast and long-lasting double play against heartburn by Mobile Clean 5000, seriously tough oil. By Little Man, starring Marlon Wayans and Sean Wayans in theaters July 14th. And by Bank of America, keep the change only from Bank of America.
Little Man, small strike zone. I can't wait to see that movie.
I will see that movie, I have to say, and that's not shilling. That's
no.
I just have to, when I see the trailer for it, it just makes me laugh.
So hilarious. It's funny.
Alex Rodriguez, strike one. He's walked, single, home, a run, and grounded out. Oh, and 2 the count. Billy Wagner has solidified the back end of the bullpen. He has blown 4 saves this season. This game is not headed in that direction. We were there for one of them when these two teams matched up at Shea earlier in the year. That's just a little flick of the wrist. And look at that. Home run by Alex Rodriguez. And you talk about making it look easy. I know it's a short porch, but he just flipped it into the seats and right. It's 8-3.
Most of our viewing audience not too young to remember flick of my bick. This is a flick of his bat. Fastball up and away. And a rocket out to right field.
So he is happy that the calendar says July after a rough June. 2 RBIs today, driven in 2 of the 3 runs as ball 1 misses down and into Posada. Two and oh from Heilman. No action for the Mets in their bullpen. Word on Steve Trachsel, by the way, left the game with tightness in his right groin. He is day to day. But either way, around that time when he left in the 7th after the leadoff walk, or actually base hit by Cairo, he was over 100 pitches and probably toward the end of his day as it was. 3-0 now from Heilman to Posada.
Joe, considering the booing of A-Rod by Yankees fans, I think it's interesting to note the booing in different sports. I mean, with the World Cup going on right now, you hear the whistling and jeering. There's no booing in golf. There's whistling and jeering in tennis. Booing in football is almost a group booing. Basketball, you rarely hear about booing. Same with hockey, but baseball seems to be the perfect arena to boo an individual and to have it affecting and to isolate him and single him out.
Here's a 3-2 to Posada. He strikes out on a changeup from Aaron Heilman. And he has said as much, that how can you not hear the reaction of the crowd, and how can it not? You would be inhuman to come with a $25 million per year price tag, fail to meet expectations last year in the postseason with no RBIs after winning the MVP award, or at least having the season which would win him the MVP award. And then to go through the kind of June he went through, and he said, yeah, I hear it. And it's got to make him press, but maybe the month of July, as silly as that is, just another day later, different month, and he's had a much better afternoon today against the Mets. 1-1. Needless to say that if the Yankees are going to do anything the rest of this season and make the postseason by winning the division or being a wild card, Alex Rodriguez is going to have to be right in the middle of it.
That's right.
If he's not, it's not going to happen. Strike 2 on Andy Phillips.
I always thought about booing and what compels people to boo. One thing that people do not boo, or people that people do not boo, is mediocrity. Nobody shoots for anybody who's mediocre to boo.
Back-to-back strikeouts after the home run. And there are critics, and they have said, well, yeah, it's an 8-2 game. He hits a home run. It's 8-3. Big deal. His second at bat after walking in the first, he drove home a run with a bases loaded single to left with a 1-2 count, which at the time got the Yankees on the board. They had a chance to take the lead and could not get over the hump. 2 out, nobody on. Melky Cabrera takes a strike. 1-3 on the day. One ball, 1 strike. Cabrera goes the other way and gets his second hit of the day. And Bernie Williams will get an at-bat for Bubba Crosby. They still love him here at Yankee Stadium. And why not with the numbers he's put up over a great career here in New York? He's had a good year and many more at-bats than he or the Yankees expected coming into the season. In front of a changeup and a pop-up. Woodward is there. And we go to the ninth. The home run in the inning by Alex Rodriguez makes it a five-run game, 8-3. Mets on top as they'll bat in the ninth. A little flick of the wrists by Alex Rodriguez, his 17th of the season. It's 8-3. Bernie Williams, who pinch hit, stays in the game. He's in right. Matt Smith, the lefty, is back to work. Castro, Marrero, and Reyes, the hitters, and Castro takes a ball. Ramon, a big hit. A two-run single back in the fourth inning, later scored a run on a hit by LoDuca. That was the five-run fourth inning, which is the difference in this game. Ooh, back at Smith, and Matt able to get out of the way of it. A leadoff hit. Our Holiday Inn Look Again play of the game brought to you by Holiday Inn, the official hotel for Major League Baseball. After the Mets picked up one hit all of last night, this is the third hit way back in the first inning. A hit by Reyes, a double by LoDuca, and a two-run double by David Wright. Made it 2-0. The Yankees tied it in the third, and the Mets went back out on top with a five-run fourth. Each team has a run since then. One of them on a home run by Eli Marrero, who takes a ball up and away.
It could be drudgery for a catcher the day after a night game. You're dog tired. Your second game of catching in less than 24 hours for Jorge Posada. Playing against the team that has a considerable lead, and you get one in the dirt in the ninth inning. Gosh, I missed that.
No. I bet.
I'm ready. What are we talking about?
Ken, the whole world can hear you right now. Or at least those tuned into Fox Saturday Baseball.
Your battery's working now, Ken.
Now your battery works.
Thanks, guys.
You know what I was going
to say? Glad to be with you.
Yeah. Do you have any sunblock?
I do not.
I want to dip into the petty cash and get some of that for Ken next week. One on with nobody out. 2-1 pitch to Eli Marrero from Matt Smith. In for a strike. Billy Wagner is getting loose for the Mets out in their bullpen. We were there earlier in the year, the 20th of May, when Wagner at Shea Stadium came in on a Saturday with a 4-0 lead and blew the save. The Mets eventually lost the game. And it looks like Billy Wagner, probably just to get some work, is getting ready to come into this game despite what is now a five-run lead as Marrero strikes out. Was there any fallout from that when we were witnessing that back in May, Ken?
There was, Joe, and I had a talk with Wagner about that yesterday, and he said he was caught totally off guard to enter that game with a four-run lead. He just wasn't mentally there, and he had pitched with four-run leads in Philadelphia and Houston in smaller ballparks. It was something he did quite often. He just hadn't been in that situation with the Mets. So afterward, he met with Willie Randolph, he apologized, and they got on the same page. I'm sure he's ready to pitch today.
Here's Reyes, one on, one out. Smith just picked up his first strikeout. Ball one down and in. Reyes today with two hits, two runs scored, an RBI, two out of four. White Sox now out in front at Chicago, and Houston shut out Texas. So you can look at the Chicago game one of two ways. The Cubs' misery continues, or the White Sox fantastic play continues. They're in the ninth inning and leading 8-6 over the Northsiders. Line drive, one hop. Good pick by Cairo. Got them both. 4-6-3. Brilliantly turned by Cairo and Jeter.
Boy, this is a big league double play right here.
Woo. Bottom of the ninth inning. Billy Wagner takes over here in the ninth inning. He hasn't pitched since Sunday. And the Mets are playing Toronto, so here he is just getting some work. It's not that Willie Randolph is paranoid about a five-run lead at the moment, but he wants to make sure that Wagner gets that arm stretched out. They have a night game tomorrow night. These two clubs do as they wrap up this set. Chacon against Soler tomorrow night. One ball, one strike from Wagner.
Often if your starter doesn't work for a 4 or 5 day period, that could be a good thing. But not in the Mets' case. After that appearance on Sunday in Toronto, the Mets had an off day on Monday and then lost the three in a row in Boston. Wagner had no chance to pitch. And last night they lost to the Yankees 2-0. So Billy couldn't come in there.
Blows away Cairo with 97 mile an hour heat. One out here in the bottom of the ninth inning. In that game at Shea Stadium, Wagner came in up 3-0, or rather 4-0, and gave up a hit, a walk, an RBI hit, got an out, a walk, another walk with the bases loaded to force home a run, then hit a batter to force home a run. He left. The Yankees tied it against Feliciano and won it in the 11th. One ball, one strike. Damon two out of three with a pair of singles. He's popped up, walked. And now in the hole, 1-2. Today's game produced by Pete Macheska, directed by Bill Webb. Our thanks to Steve Horn, our editorial consultant in the booth, our associate director, Aaron Stoikov, and our broadcast associate is Kevin Dresser. Our technical producer is Sid Drexler. That's up and away. Jonathan Evans, Wayne Fittleman, Dave Corris, Dave Schwabe. Boy, it takes a lot of people to put these games on. Ed Curtis. There's a strike over the outside corner, two out. Our Chevrolet player of the game, Ramon Castro. In the third inning, a two-run single, later a run scored, and in recognition of his outstanding hit, Chevrolet makes a $1,000 contribution to the Boys and Girls Clubs of America, Chevy and American Revolution. Here's Jeter. Ball one. Coordinating producer of the pregame show, Scott Ackerson, produced by Gary Lang and directed by Bob Levy. The senior producer of Fox Sports is Bill Brown, and the executive producers are Ed Gorin and David Hill. Two out here in the bottom of the ninth inning. 8-3, the Mets on top, and Wagner is nailing it down. Good breaking ball, strike two. Filthy.
Filthy is right.
Can he strike out the side? Nice play by Franco. And a play at first, and hopefully Wagner is okay.
Oh, boy, that jamming that right heel on that play. That's the type of thing that can really hurt a guy, and that's the disadvantage of bringing in your number one guy and your number one closer in a five-run game.
Walking around with a little limp out there in the middle of the field, and that's not a good sign for the Mets. In a five-run game, they bring in Wagner. That throw from Franco made Billy Wagner stretch for it, and he comes out gimpy after slamming that right foot down on the base. It's an 8-3 win for the Mets. Their four-game losing streak is over, and these two teams have split the first two games of this set. For Ken Rosenthal and Tim McCarver, I'm Joe Buck. Mets win it, a final of 8-3, and hopefully Billy Wagner is okay. Right now, Jeannie and Kevin in the Fox Network Center. From those of us in New York, so long.
Welcome to the Chevy Postgame Show on Fox Chevy, America's number one fan.